Well, every day after work, Mike would go to a Dublin pub, Patty's Pub, actually it was. And so he would go into the pub after work and order 3 beers. Well, this went on day after day. And so finally, Patty came up to Mike and said, "Mike, I hope you don't mind if I ask, but why do you always come in after work and order 3 beers?" Well, Mike said, "Patty, it's like this. I have 2 other brothers, and one went off and went to America, and the other one went off to Australia. And so we decided that when we would order beer, we would order 2 more beers in memory of the 2 missing brothers." And Patty said, "Well, that's nice." Well, one day, Mike came into the pub and ordered only 2 beers. And so Pat said, "Oh, something must have happened." So he went over to Mike, he says, "I'm sorry, your brothers must have passed away." And Mike said, "Oh no, that's not it at all, Patty. I just gave up drinking for Lent." Well, that's not a true story, but this one is. John Dunn's father owned a garage, and a trucker drove in for some service. When it came time for the bill, the trucker suggested to Don a few extras, saying, "The company will pay for it and we can split the difference." And Don's father said, "No thanks." Well, the driver pushed the point. He said, "Look, I'm going to be a good customer here. Why shouldn't we all profit from the little extra service you offer?" And Don's father said, "No, that's not my style." The driver persisted. And finally, Don's father said, "You know, take your business somewhere else." And the driver said, "I'll not go elsewhere. I own a trucking firm. And I just wanted to be sure you were a mechanic I could trust." So Don's father resisted the temptation to earn a few extra bucks. And in a sense, that's what Lent is all about in many ways, is resisting temptation through prayer, fasting, and good works. But it's not just that. There's something more positive to Lent as well. But that's a good start. That through prayer, fasting, and good works, it's important that we struggle to resist temptation, just like Don's father did. Well, in the gospel today, really pretty sharp gospel, but Jesus wants us to remember just 2 things. One, to repent. And number 2, he says, believe in the gospel. Very 2 simple things to remember from the readings today, especially from the gospel. Repent and believe in the gospel. Well, to repent simply means to turn away from sin. And when we come into church, as we do every Sunday, the first thing we do is repent of our sin, which is a good thing to get us ready to listen to the good news, to the gospel. So repent, especially in Lent, is really an important element that we need to try to practice. And one of them would simply be, you know, to repent of our sins and to pray. But during Lent, or for that matter, any time, it's a good time to make a good confession, simply to repent, to be sorry to God in this beautiful sacrament of reconciliation. So let's keep that in mind during these 40 days for all of us. But the second one is really the important one, although the first one's really important too, but it's more negative, to get rid of things, to get rid of our sins and the darkness in our life. But now the positive thing is to believe in the gospel, to believe in Jesus. Jesus is the gospel. He is the good news. When you open the Bible in a prayerful way, you are opening your heart to the living Word of God speaking to you personally. And it's important. You can do this in your home. When If you open the Bible, realize that this is the living Word of God. And when you open it prayerfully, you are very, very much in the presence of Jesus, who comes to you, especially in the Gospels. William Murray was an atheist for over 30 years. Some of you might remember his mother. His mother was Madeline Murray O'Hare. As an atheist, she challenged the practice of praying and reading the Bible in public schools. Well, it went all the way to the Supreme Court and ended in banning all prayer and all Bible reading in the nation's public schools. And William, her son, for some 30 years carried his anti-God crusade into print. He published an atheistic magazine. But William was also a fan, strangely enough, of a very famous author, Taylor Caldwell. And Taylor Caldwell wrote many religious books. And he had just finished the book, Dear and Glorious Physician, a book about St. Luke, the author of the Gospel of Luke. Well, one night in San Francisco, William had a vivid dream about the Bible, and the dream made him wake up. It was so vivid. The dream was so real that he got out of bed and drove to an all-night discount store. He says, there, under a stack of porno magazines, I found a Bible. I drove back to my apartment and read the Gospel of Luke. There, I found Jesus. There I found Jesus. Pope Francis is always telling us to read the Gospels. He says, in the Gospels you will find Jesus. And the Pope told the people one Sunday in the piazza during the Angelus to carry a little pocket edition of the Gospels in your pocket. And then he had pocket editions of the Gospel passed out to all the people in the piazza in all different languages. So he wasn't just talking in the air. He wanted to make sure these people got a little Gospel pocketbook. And then he went on to say, when we leave home, if we forget our cell phone, we would often say, oh my gosh, I forgot my cell phone, so I better run back and get it. He says, wouldn't it be nice if we felt the same way if we left that little Gospel book at home? Oh my gosh, I forgot my Gospel book. I should go back and get it. But sometimes we all can't carry a little pocketbook of Gospels in our pocket. We can carry a little rosary with 10 beads on it. And you can reach in any time during the day and start praying some of the beads. Pray them throughout the day. So you carry Jesus and Mary with you in that way through a prayerful day, dropping off little Hail Marys, wherever you are, in the car, say the rosary, standing in line at the grocery store, pray a few Hail Marys for the people there, in the waiting room or waiting for somebody. There's so many ways throughout the day we can drop, as I call them, popcorn prayers throughout the day. The whole purpose of Lent is to fall in love more with Jesus, to make Jesus your best friend. He will never leave you. He will never betray you. He will always be faithful to you. I would like all of you to do just one thing during this Lent as your homework. Pick up the Bible at home and read one of the four Gospels all the way through. Read it slowly and prayerfully during these 40 days of Lent. And you will find that you will fall more in love with Jesus, and that Jesus is real, is alive, and is very close to you. And especially when you open the Bible prayerfully and sit in his presence, you're actually in the presence of Jesus. Certainly you can go to church and be in the presence of Jesus in the tabernacle, but just as surely you can open your Bible at home and be in the presence of Jesus in your own home. And you will never feel alone or unloved if you open your heart in prayer to Jesus in the Gospels and make him your best friend, the one person you love above all other loves in your life. There's one quote, part including this, is from Father Arupe. He was a farmer general, superior general of the Jesuits. And he wrote his little sharp prayer, this little sharp prayer in a way. It says, love decides everything. Nothing is more practical than finding God. That is, than falling in love in a quite absolute, final way. What you are in love with, what seizes your imagination, will affect everything. It will decide what will get you out of bed in the morning, what you will do with your evenings, how you will spend your weekends, what you read, who you know, what breaks your heart, and what amazes you with joy and gratitude. Fall in love, stay in love, and it will decide everything. Fall in love with Jesus, stay in love with Jesus, and He will decide everything.